It's your girl Deshonda Carter, but you can call me DC. Thanks so much for tuning in today to my show, When the Blue Comes Off. Sit back, relax, take notes, do what you like, and let's get into it. Hey everybody, it's your girl Deshonda Carter, but you can call me what? DC! October is Cancer and Domestic Violence Awareness Month. Today's show will be dedicated to cancer awareness. I have two special, wonderful ladies who are going to talk to us today and tell us how cancer affected their lives. So sit back, relax, and let's get into it. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome my special guest, Michelle Bacon of the New York City Department of Correction, civilian employee. Welcome, Michelle.
Hi there, how are you?
I am great. Thank you for coming on such last minute. I just wanted to introduce you to the people and your and the great works that you do pertaining to cancer awareness. Can you just introduce yourself to the people and tell them what it is that you do and why you do what you do?
So again, my name is Michelle Bacon. I am a health service manager with the New York City Department of Corrections. I've been with the department for 29 years. I manage the HIV contract and with the department, and doing such, I started being actively involved in the AIDS walk. So the team that I work with, we would do that and fundraisers for the AIDS walk, and then it sort of just morphed into, oh, now there's something else that we can collectively do, and we decided to do the breast cancer walk and do fundraising. At some point, we came, of course, the idea of, wow, why don't we do something even bigger? The idea was a lot of people that were experiencing cancer treatment were losing their hair, and for ladies, they didn't feel really good about themselves. And one of those persons happened to be my mother. So October the 15th, of 2016, we had an event called Pretty in Pink. The goal of the event was to bring cancer awareness, and it was also to allow a time for those that are cancer survivors to feel beautiful and to look beautiful, and also to raise funds. So that's how Pretty in Pink came about. We have had, I think, four or five Pretty in Pink events thus far, and we've donated each event $10,000 to the American Cancer Society, and this is all the help and effort of my colleagues in DOC and as the team that's the Pretty in Pink organization.
So that was a team effort, and that's something that you continuously have done since 2015, correct?
2016.
So you've been in corrections for a very long time. Is this going to be a passion that you continue to pursue after you retire?
Absolutely. And one of the reasons that in doing this, I've worked in the department so long, and we found out there are a lot of our colleagues in the department that had cancer. And it was just, and this was the focus. It was to also, it boosts morale and allow people to know others. We care about each other in DOC to emphasize the care component of care, custody, and control. And it was all of that came about to say we care about each other working here in DOC. So most of the people have been either DOC employees or family members of DOC employees the entire time that we've had these events that have been very, very successful in bringing awareness, working with the care unit, making sure when they bring the buzz for mammograms, giving people information and literature, and just making people feel good and letting them know that as survivors, you do get to live again. And thank you for sharing your story, being courageous enough and generous enough to allow us to hear your story about things that you've gone through that we won't have to go through the same thing. So I'm grateful to them, all of our survivors, very grateful to them.
And just so people will know, you guys may not know, Michelle Bacon is not just a woman of random that I chose to speak to today because she had a foundation or she had an organization. She is also my sister and Melanin Sisters United, which is another organization that was brought together by the founder, Tina Booker, who has been on the show in the past, and I felt it very important that we speak to her pertaining all the good works that she has done for the community. Now, just so you guys also know, I recently launched a t-shirt brand, Simply Carter's Tees and Things. The first t-shirts that we launched were the law enforcement t-shirts, which were to gain funds to be donated to organizations for cancer awareness and domestic violence awareness. And the first organization that we decided to donate to was the Pretty in Pink Foundation, because Michelle Bacon, again, being my Melanin Magic sister, Melanin Sister United sister. That's a tongue mm-hmm. twister, Michelle. But I wanted to give to her directly because I know of the good works that she does. In addition, she's also my DOC sister. So it all comes full circle, how we work together, how we support each other. And I think it's very important that we all stay connected, especially in this trying time and what the department is going through.
Yeah.
There are so many people still not only fighting with their, you know, their work conditions, but their health conditions, their personal conditions. And just because work is going on, life doesn't stop. And I am so thankful that you are there and are a godsend to the people and all that you do for them. Unfortunately,
thank
we haven't
so
been.
Much.
You're welcome. You know, I
just wanted to say that. No, I'm very grateful, but I'm also very thankful that I've been blessed with a team. I have done not one thing by myself. I've just been blessed with a team of people who said, "Let's go and let's be God's hand extended. Let's do something for somebody else. Let's see, you know." And every time we do it, it's always blessed. And it's for someone else. And, you know, it's not just Michelle. It is a group of us. And they're the best people ever. So I want to say that, too.
Of course. Well, listen, DOC, our team, everybody, yes, mm-hmm. has a team that comes together. We do nothing alone in DOC. So, that's a given when it says you can't do it alone, because you can't, you know.
And but you know what? Also, with everything that we're hearing now and all of the things that you hear and all of this stuff, it may be true and disheartening in some ways where DOC is concerned, but there's some great, great, great things that have come out of DOC, and we can never forget that, and we still have to see what we can do to keep us, it, and the people that are our community, serviced. So, you know, I just want to say that too. There's some great people and great, great things that have come out of DLC. Love, people who have given up themselves, including you, DeShonda.
Oh.
So I wanted to say that.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much. And again, I don't want to hold you too long. I just wanted people to know about your foundation, know about your organization, what you're doing. The Pretty in Pink organization will be coming full throttle and becoming a nonprofit relatively soon. And I just want people to know to be on the lookout for that. I mean, the social media will be coming, all the things that will be blossoming into a full-fledged foundation. So we want to keep you guys posted, and I wanted you to hear it first from the creator herself, Michelle Bacon. And
thank you
again, Michelle, for just sharing a tidbit of your story during this Cancer Awareness Month. And I look forward to working with you relatively soon and seeing you soon. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome my special guest, my Melanin Sisters United little baby, Miss Scarlet. Welcome, Scarlet.
Hi, Auntie. Thank you for having me tonight. I'm super excited about this conversation.
Thank you for being on. I know it was last minute. I was like, you know, when I was working on the show this week, and I was like, oh my God, you know, I didn't realize. I'm like, this is Cancer and Domestic Violence Awareness Month, and I really wanted to bring on people who were affected or have direct connection with these two entities. And being that I the first part of the show will be actually Michelle Bacon, right, who is going to discuss the Pretty in Pink, and I said, oh my God, Scarlet, let me talk to Scarlet. So tell the people what's going on with you, Scarlet.
Alrighty, so in June 23rd, if I'm not mistaken, I was diagnosed with papillary thyroid cancer. So it's a cancer directly on my thyroid. It has been honestly a game changer, to say the least. This has really changed the way that I view life. It has changed the way that I think, the way that I want to move. My entire village has shifted because of it as well. Cancer has been, I was annoyed by the cancer, of course, because it's cancer nonetheless. But at the same time, I took it as an opportunity to find a way to relearn how to live my life again. So scary, but definitely necessary in this season for the things that I'm going to grow into, as far as like being an entrepreneur, as far as like working on being someone's wife in the future and things of that nature. So cancer changed the game for me.
What was an indicator for you? Was it something that you weren't feeling well for a long time? Was it something that you just happened to go to the doctor and they said, hey, we noticed something? Like, how did you get this diagnosis?
So I got this diagnosis mainly because, and I didn't realize it at first, but it was mainly because I was so tired all the time. Like, if you talk to anyone around me who was like very close to me, they know that I'm like the nap queen. Like, in order for me to focus on my day, I have to take a nap in the middle of the day. So that was like the first indicator, because it became like, like, I needed to take a nap. Like, if I didn't take a nap, then it wasn't really good for me. I was extremely, extremely exhausted, and I didn't understand why at first. But I just thought that was, you know, kind of normal, me kind of growing up, becoming, you know, more of an adult. So I didn't take it too seriously. But in December of 2020, I noticed that, my doctor, primary doctor, noticed that my TSH levels were very, very high, and that was a little bit concerning. But they just said, let's monitor it, let's come back in 3 months, do the testing again, and then go from there. So in March, we redid the testing. March or April of this year, we redid the testing. My levels were still high, and my calcium was also very high as well. So they were more concerned about my health, and they said, let's continue doing further testing, let's do an ultrasound, echo, and things of that nature. So we got into that. But what really did it for real is that in late March, I noticed, I was talking to one of my good girlfriends about, like, you know, going back and forth to the doctors. At that point, I was kind of going pretty often. I had like a ton of appointments lined up just to get everything together, my general health, but mainly my thyroid. And as I was video chatting her, I was explaining to her like what the thyroid was, and, you know, where is it located, and why my primary doctor was concerned and not noticed the lump on my throat. And I've never noticed it before, and I don't know how I didn't notice, but I did. And it looked pretty big at the time too. So after I noticed the lump, I hung up with my best friend, and then I reached back out to my primary doctor, and I was like, "Did you not see the lump in my throat?" She was like, "Huh? What?" Like, she was lost, and that kind of pissed me off a little bit. But I went back, and she looked at the lump, and she was like, "The results came back. My calcium was high." And honestly, like, my primary doctor is not the best, to be honest. And the way that she nonchalantly, she was like, "Oh, your calcium is high. It might be cancer, but let's do further testing to see." And I was like, "Girl, what? Like, you're just gonna throw that word around like it's nothing?" But lo and behold, after doing more testing at one hospital, I found out that I do have papillary thyroid cancer. So that was kind of like the diagnosing process. And from then, I kind of switched my hospital because I didn't feel comfortable with the care that I was receiving at one hospital. So I needed to switch over. So now I'm with another doctor. I have a whole care team, and they have been doing a pretty good job with kind of keeping me in the loop, making sure I understand what's going on and making sure I know like what's to come, the possibilities. Because with thyroid cancer, or any cancer in general, but with thyroid cancer for me, they won't know what it's gonna look like after surgery until like the surgery is done. So everything is kind of up in the air. So it's a very, very scary time to deal with this. And being an entrepreneur and being very self independent and self motivated, it has really encouraged me to depend on my village and my family. And this is like the family that created, the family that's around me as well, that was kind of brought into, birthed into. But the village that I created has been like A1, including my aunties, including my melanin sisters united, aunties and sisters and everybody. It's been great to have that support system. And I think that I strongly believe that before the cancer, within the last couple of years, I've been really, really honing down on the people who are supposed to be around me moving forward in my life. So it was good to kind of be able to let these people love on me the way that I needed to be loved during this season.
That's the blessing that you have.
Okay.
Right, because a lot of people who are in the situation that you're in can't say that they have a great support system. And I know firsthand that you are loved and you have a huge, huge support system. And you know, God is gonna be with you through this time.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, you got some praying sisters that's on there. You know, let's just talk about, you know, who's on your team. So you are really, really in good hands. But let me ask you, how has this, aside from your personal life, how has this affected your business? Because you had just recently, if I'm not mistaken, like maybe within the last 2 years, right before COVID really came to be, you had quit the regular 9-to-5 world, and you had stepped out, right, and started your own business. And now with the diagnosis, like, so how is all of that coming into play? Like, tell the people, what was your business, and now how it is the cancer has affected your business?
Sure. So it's funny because my last day of work was the first day that the city shut down for COVID. Like, that was my last day of working a 9-to-5. And I gave her 3 weeks because I was there for so long, and I knew that replacing me would take some time, or having someone step in to take over the things of my responsibilities would take some time, and I was open to continue training people. It was literally the day that the city shut down, that was my last day of working a 9-to-5. So stepping into being a full-time entrepreneur wasn't something that was very new to me, because I did it before. However, I didn't feel like I had the resources or the knowledge to do it. And it wasn't the right business to step into at first. But this time around, I had way more knowledge. I'm glad that I was in a position where I was kind of taught all the ins and outs of a business. So that gave me everything that I needed to kind of step out on my own. And I started Royal Goodies Box, which is a bi-monthly subscription box, mainly for women, but we did have something for men this year. And that was to kind of encourage self-care within the home. So all of it was skin products. We were doing like soaps and body butters and body oils, things of that nature, to kind of just encourage to continue doing self-care at home, especially during the pandemic where people weren't comfortable going out, the city was shut down. So that's what I started last year. Last year in June as well. Wow, June is a very significant month, isn't it? So I started that business in June 2020, and a year later I found out that I had cancer, and I did a really good job the first year because it was bi-monthly. I was still kind of finding my footing with the business. Mm-hmm. But I did do a pretty good job with numbers. This year I was able to sell out boxes as well, so we were getting the momentum that we needed to make the business grow and to continue growing in the business as well. So it was crazy to have to stop because of my diagnosis. And I think that, and I'm strongly believing that the main reason why I had to stop is because like my entire young adult life and into my grown adult life, I've been working so much. Like I've been working almost nonstop since I was about 15, 16. So,
and how old are you
nonstop,
now? How old are you now?
I just turned 27. Okay. So about 10 years. So nonstop, I was working so much, like working myself to the ground, not resting, not taking care of myself, even though I had a whole annual event to encourage people to rest, but I wasn't doing it. I was kind of being a
Isn't that what most entrepreneurs do? Like
we do it for other people because we need it, you know.
Right.
So we have to come for our own lives and encourage ourselves to do it. But it did start become a little bit more normal to take care of myself a little bit more. But it still wasn't to the extent that I needed to be able to move within this realm in a healthy manner. So
I think we as people, especially women, we need to normalize taking care of ourselves.
Absolutely.
We have a tendency to go nonstop all the time for everyone else. The kids, the husband, the job, everything except ourselves. And I think for me, you know, I'm all over the place. And I feel like my body always tells me when it's time to break.
Right.
You know?
Right.
And that is the one thing I'm getting better at.
Mm-hmm.
And that's like, okay, no, I'm not doing that. No, I'm going to stay home.
No, the power of no. Like, yeah. It's so important to be able to say no. And what I learned this year specifically is even God had to rest. Right. So who do I think I am? Who do I think I am trying to go a mile a minute every single day if God had to rest? That's in the Bible rest. It's in the Bible. Right. So I had to learn that. I'm like, oh, snap.
Let me pause for a second. Right.
But I think that although, like I said, cancer is cancer. It's scary regardless, but it definitely gave me the opportunity to sit down for a long time, and I'm still kind of sitting down.
Well, and you deserve to sit down. You know what I mean? Because like, I know you work very hard.
Okay.
For young people, like, you have a great work ethic. For a young lady, like, you don't find that in too many young people nowadays, but your work ethic is so superb, and you do an efficient job. It's not like you half-ass do the work. You give it 100%, and that is what's important.
But, yeah, and that's also the issue too, is that
you give it too
I'm
much.
So used to, it's that too, but because I only want to give 100%, half-assing is not in my DNA.
Right.
So if I have to half-ass something, I'd rather not do it, which is why I had to sit down for the last 3 months and just kind of just rest and learn and just accept my situation, which is still a process in its own, accepting this situation. Like, sometimes I wake up like, wow. Cancer for real,
right? Right.
This is what we're doing.
But in it all, you still have your—you know—you have not let it beat you. You have not become in a sunken place, because you know typically someone can become just devastated to the point where they just can't function at all. Because being diagnosed with cancer, to me, it is devastating, you know, because now, not only are you diagnosed with cancer now, but we have the COVID, you know what I mean? So it's like, it's in a time where you would once have to just deal with cancer, but you got all of these other things. Now this is an underlying condition. You have to worry about the people here around with the different variants that's going around with the COVID. So it does give you a lot more to think of, but you are in just such great spirits. Like, it's amazing.
I'm not gonna say that I'm always in good spirits. Like last night I was boo-hooing, you know, like last night I was boo-hooing, let's be honest. But I had to learn and understand that this is not a death sentence. This is just a temporary issue that I'm dealing with, and I'm gonna get through it. There's one thing that I know and I understand is that this too shall pass. When, I don't know, that's still something I'm talking to God about, but it will. So that's the one thing that I can honestly say that has been keeping me in good spirits, is because I know that this is going to be a part of my testimony, and this is something that I have to go through in this season to become a better version of myself. So those are the things that like kind of keeps me going. But I do have my moments where I'm just like, this ain't it. What are we doing? But at the same time, I know that I play an important role in some people's lives, and who am I to not serve people just because I have cancer? And when I say serve people, I don't mean that I'm working for anybody else, but to make sure that I remind people that I love them, and I remind people that, you know, that I'm here for them. My life hasn't stopped. My work has, honestly, but my life hasn't stopped just because of it. It's a pause. It's something that, you know, I needed a break from. I had to park in the lot for a little bit, I'm still doing whatever I can to make sure that I let people know. And that's the reason why I love having conversations like this and being on social media and being transparent, because especially on social media, people do an amazing job with faking the funk. Like, people swear that their lives are perfect, and they swear that they're not going through anything. They post a lot of the positive stuff, not understanding and not realizing that the bad stuff that you go through, the negative stuff that you go through, is also part of your story. Not everybody has the strength to share that, though. And I've been finding the strength, because it's honestly good for me too. Like, I find peace with being able to tell people, like, yo, I'm having a bad day. And people have been reaching out like, girl, I'm having a bad day too. You want to talk about our bad days? Let's talk about our bad days.
And find comfort.
It's not about me.
Each other. Yeah. Comforting each other. Yeah.
Yeah. And I'm a woman of the people. So I will always try to find a way to continue serving people, even in this season. And, you know, I know my limits. I know how to say no now, thank God, because, child, I was saying yes to everything.
Right.
Everything under the sun. Yes, yes, yes.
Yeah, I'll get that done. Oh, yeah, I'll be there. I'll take care
now
of that.
Now I got 8 things to do in one day, and I don't even have time to take care of the things I need to take care of myself.
Right.
Like, it was just unfair. The way that I was treating myself was very, very unfair. But now I'm learning to give myself grace. That's the word of 2021, is grace.
Amen.
I had to learn how to give myself so much grace, because I'm still human. I'm still gonna fall. I'm still gonna cry. I'm still gonna deal with these, you know, not so good emotions and feelings sometimes, and that's okay. Like, saying no is okay. Being like, I'm probably not going to work on my business right now. It's okay because I deserve to not do anything for a little bit. I deserve it. And again, that's still something that I'm learning how to accept. For real. It's been a journey, but I don't know. Like, I'm grateful for the people that are around me because they have definitely been pushing me to be like, all right, sit down, you know, it's okay. I'd be like, what am I gonna do? Nothing. Don't do anything.
Right.
They do a good job of reminding me that I'm not supposed to do what I'm used to doing, the way that I was used to be, that I was used to doing it. So thank God for them. Thank God for the many lessons.
Even though you're not doing it physically, one of the things that I find that even in my solitude, my mind is always working. And girl, I have to figure out a way to shut that off.
Yeah. Or even if you don't shut it off, like what I'm understanding this for this last quarter is a season of preparation for the next quarter. So even if I'm not doing any of the work, I'm still writing these ideas down. Whatever season's being sought into my spirit, I just write them down. Just because, like, if you keep it in your head sometimes, then it's going to keep staying there. Sometimes you just got to release it somewhere, whether you're talking to somebody in your village or you're just writing in one of your notebooks. You got to release some of that stuff because it's coming for a reason. Right. A lot of the ideas that I have been getting have been amazing. They have been really, really good. So I'm just writing things down. And if I can work on it every once in a while, I'll do that. I'll give myself enough grace to do that. But I no longer overwork myself. I no longer push myself to the extent where I'm uncomfortable or anything like that. So,
well, I just want to thank you so much, Miss Scarlet, for coming onto the show and sharing your story with us. And, you know, there are people out there that are just being diagnosed this week, are being diagnosed as we speak, and they needed this word from you, and they needed the encouragement from you to say, you know what, it's not a death sentence, and to take the advice to get around the correct people that's going to love on you and support you and not cause you any unnecessary drama or stress that can hinder your healing process.
Yeah.
So that's very important, you know? And even though you're not working on the goodie box right now, I mean, can we expect something for the holidays possibly? And if not, give your socials just so that people can follow you if they want to be in support of your journey, where they can, you know, maybe give you a message of encouragement and then maybe be notified once the business is back up and running so they can become subscribers. So let's just share that information with the people.
Sure. So I'm waiting. I'm right now awaiting a date for surgery. So I don't know when I'm going to launch anything yet. I did start a New York inspired anti-cancer campaign line. I did start that, but I haven't really necessarily been pushing it too much, just because I know that once the surgery happens, I don't know how long I'm going to be out the game. But you can follow me on Instagram, The Scarlet Experience. On Facebook, I also have a page there, The Scarlet Experience, and Scarlet with one T, not two, Scarlet with one T. You can also follow me on Twitter, Scarlet Speaks, and you can follow my businesses, Royal Goodies with an S box, on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter as well. Those are my handles.
Yes, guys, make sure you follow this young lady. She is someone who is just an exemplary role model for today's young ladies. And I just love her wholeheartedly. Like, my spirit, when I met her, and once I had joined the Melanin Sisters United, like, you are the youngest one in our group.
Yeah.
So, you know, she's everybody's niece. But when I tell you, her work ethic speaks volumes. And I can tell you, like, when I look at her, I'm just very proud to see how she is so mature and so about her business. And you don't really get that. Like I said, I do not see that in the vast majority of young people today. But you know, I'm praying for you. You know, I'm here for you. And I hope that people that are out there, I want you guys to reach out, give words of encouragement, support. And if you or anyone you know are going through this time of diagnosis or being diagnosed or in remission, and you just want to connect with someone, you have her social media handles. Reach out, talk to each other, encourage each other, and just stay faithful and prayed up. And again, Scarlet, thank you so much for being here, and I will look to reach out to you relatively soon.
Okay.
And
thank you.
You know,
auntie.
I
thank
love you.
For having
you.
Me.
You know, I love you. So,
I love you too.
Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Scarlet.
Thank you, auntie.
Hey, it's DeShonda Carter here, and I have a quick question for you. Do you know any young ladies between the ages of 5 and 15 who are current business owners or are looking to be business owners? Well, if so, then they need to be a part of the Diva Glam Future Boss Pageant. It's not a pageant about beauty. It's a pageant about the grind. For further information, give me an email at simplycartercorp@gmail.com or DM me on any of my social media. I hope you guys are enjoying the show thus far. I just wanted to speak in memorandum of a very, very close friend of mine who passed away from leukemia many years ago. She was my best friend. Her name was Betty Bernard. And Betty was my friend from the time I was 11 years old until she passed away. I was approximately 30, 32, somewhere in there. And I just couldn't believe that my friend was gone. And I think that was the first time that cancer had really affected my life directly. I remember going to see her in the hospital, and I thought she would be coming home. I'm not a person who is big on visiting people in the hospital. It just does something to me. And I think, especially while I was younger, now I may be more willing to go, only because I've seen so many people pass away and you think that they'll be okay. And it's like, oh, I'll see them when they come home, and they don't make it home. And that is what happened to my friend. I saw her in the hospital, and I just, like I said, I thought she was coming home. You couldn't tell me that she wasn't. And I remember calling the room, because I called her every day, and she didn't answer the phone. I wanted to just touch base with her because I was going away, and I wanted to let her know I was going to be gone, like, you know, just normal check-in. And then the phone called back. So I said, oh, maybe she was in the bathroom. So I answered the phone, and it was her sister. And I said, hey, you know, what's going on with Betty? I just called her, and she said, well, you know, she passed away. And I just couldn't believe that my friend was gone. And this was, like I said, my friend from 11 years old. We're talking about all kinds of trouble that I got in with my friend. And all my teenage and young adult life experiences I experienced with her. I still have a photograph in my living room of a picture of her and I together. And I just wanted to speak her name in memorandum to let her spirit know that she is still thought about. And just healing. And again, to express my experiences with you all to say I'm there. I've been there with a friend who has been sick and had to be a support system to them. And I'm continuously being a support system to the people who are out there that need support, because although
as my young lady Scarlet said, cancer is not a death sentence, but you definitely need your people around you to give you that support to pull you through. So I just wanted to, like I said, in closing, pay respects and memorialize her, my friend Betty Bernard, and thank my two special guests, Michelle Bacon and Miss Scarlet, for being on the show today. Simply Carter Tees and Things have a t-shirt out that will be in support of domestic violence as well as cancer awareness. The proceeds will be going to the Pretty in Pink Foundation and a domestic violence organization as well. So if you have the opportunity to go on www.simplycartersteesandthings.com, you can purchase the I Bleed Blue or I Bleed Blue but Wear Pink and I Wear Blue but Wear Purple in support of cancer awareness and domestic violence awareness. Thank you for tuning in today. I hope that you all have a wonderful remainder of the week. God bless.
This has been brought to you by Simply Carter Corp, your one-stop shop for all of your entertainment and party needs. Contact Simply Carter Corp for any special occasion. You can find them on Facebook at Simply Carter Corp, on Instagram at Simply Carter Corp. You can check out their website at www.simplycartercorp.com. Give them a call at 845-682-0022. Or you can shoot them an email at hello@simplycartercorp.com. Simply Carter Corp, a brand for everyone.